Hello, my name is Dr. Omida, and I'm going to discuss the scalp and the face, the anatomy of the scalp and the face in this lecture series. So, you need to understand the extents of the scalp, the layers of the scalp, what's the innervation, blood supply, and lymphatic drainage of the scalp and face. So, the scalp extends from the supraorbital margin anteriorly. And posteriorly, it gets to the external occipital protuberance and the superior nuchal lines. And these are markings on the skull. Then on each side, the skull goes down to the superior temporal line. So from supraorbital margin to external occipital protuberance and the superior nuchal line, and sideways to the superior temporal lines. So this is the external occipital protuberance and the superior nuchal line. This is the superior temporal line, and supraorbital margin is at this region. Okay, so the scalp is made up of five layers. So from the word scalp, the most superficial is skin, followed by connective tissue, then aponeurosis, loose areolar tissue, and the pericranium. So those are the five layers of the scalp. Remember, the scalp is just above the skull bone. Okay, and the skull bone has three parts. There's usually an outer table, inner table, and deep lobe in between. But our main point of discussion here is the scalp. So you have five layers: the skin, connective tissue, aponeurosis, loose areolar tissue, and the pericranium. Okay, so the skin is thick skin and it's hairy, so there's hair on the scalp, and the skin is firmly attached to the epicranial aponeurosis through dense fascia. The skin has aberrant sebaceous glands, therefore, this is important because you're likely to get sebaceous cysts. Connective tissue in the scalp is the dense fibrous connective tissue that contains neurovascular structures. And this is important because, for example, when you have cut wounds, yeah, on the scalp, they tend to bleed profusely because the scalp is very well vascularized. And these blood vessels, when they are cut transversely, they cannot retract. Ideally, blood vessels are able to retract so that you reduce the bleeding, but they're prevented from retraction by the fibrous tissue. So the fibrous tissue tends to hold the two cut portions apart and leading to profuse bleeding. So you may tend to try and prevent this bleeding by applying pressure against the bone. The aponeurosis forms the frontalis anteriorly, and posteriorly is the occipitalis belly. So the aponeurosis is of occipitofrontalis muscle. So at the at anteriorly we call it frontalis, and posteriorly we call it occipitalis. So anteriorly, the frontalis originates from the skin of the forehead, and the fibers of this frontalis actually are mingled with orbicularis oculi, which is a muscle around the eye. Then the occipital belly originates from the lateral two-thirds of the superior nuchal line. Now, when you have a cut wound on the scalp involving the aponeurosis, if the cut is transverse, it tends to gape because frontalis muscle pulls anteriorly, occipitalis pulls posteriorly. So the wound tends to gape transversely. That way, it means you possibly have to stitch before the two parts actually come together. So the aponeurosis is made up of the two muscles. Then we go to the loose areolar tissue that extends anteriorly from the eyelids and posteriorly gets to the superior nuchal line. On each side, the loose areolar tissue actually extends up to the superior temporal line. The main contents of the loose areolar tissue are emissary veins, and bleeding can cause generalized scalp swelling, and that's what we call caput succedaneum in a newborn. So when a child is born and there is trauma during delivery, you can have bleeding of these emissary veins within the loose areolar tissue, And that's what I'm referring to as caput succedaneum. This loose areolar tissue is the danger layer of the scalp. Name the danger layer of the scalp, the loose areolar tissue layer. Why? Because these emissary veins, they tend to communicate scalp veins with the veins that are intracranially. So they provide, remember, emissary veins are valveless. So if you're able to give a communication between the veins on the scalp and the veins intracranially, it means that you can spread infection from outside to in. So that becomes the danger layer of the scalp. So this just shows you the emissary veins. So you can see if you have veins on the scalp and the veins in here, the emissary veins will ensure that communication between the two. So we have frontal emissary veins, parietal emissary veins, we have occipital emissary veins, mastoid emissary veins, and so on and so forth. So they're usually valveless. You have frontal, parietal, occipital, and mastoid emissary veins. They usually connect the veins of the scalp with a deep low of the skull bone through into the intracranial venous sinuses. Like this is the superior sagittal sinus. So you can actually pass infection from the scalp intracranially, but you cannot pass infection into the neck. Why? Because the occipital belly of the occipitofrontalis muscle actually inserts onto the occipital bone and the mastoid of the temporal bone. So that prevents infection from going down into the neck. Again, infection cannot spread laterally beyond the zygomatic arches because the aponeurosis, remember, is continuous to the temporal fascia and attaches to the zygomatic arch. So you cannot have infection going beyond the zygomatic arches because the aponeurosis attaches onto the arches. Infection of fluids such as pus can enter the eyelids and the root of the nose. Why? Because the frontalis muscle inserts on the skin and subcutaneous tissue around the eyelid, and it doesn't attach onto bone, unlike the occipitalis. Occipitalis was attaching onto occipital bone, but frontalis does not attach on bone. It attaches on skin and subcutaneous tissue around the eye. That's why when you have infection or fluid accumulation in the scalp, it can get around the eye, at the eyelids and the root of the nose. The pericranium is made up of periosteum, and it's loosely attached to the bone, but firmly attached onto the sutures. So if you have the pericranium, will attach onto the coronal suture, the sagittal suture, so it attaches onto the sutures firmly. Therefore, if you bleed under the pericranium, you get what you call cephalohematoma, which is limited by the sutures. So, caput succedaneum, we say bleeding of the emissary veins in the loose areolar tissue. So, the bleeding is generalized on the scalp, while cephalohematoma will be limited onto a certain bone, because remember the pericranium inserts onto the sutures, so you will not have it generalized on the whole head. It will just be, like in this case, it's limited on one side. This is black eye that is normally seen in facial injury. We also call it raccoon eyes, so or periorbital hematoma or ecchymosis. So in head injury, if you have bleeding, for example, in the scalp, it tends to spread to the eyelid, because remember we said the occipitalis, its fibers are mingled together with the orbicularis oculi, and the frontalis fibers are mingled with the orbicularis oculi, and it doesn't insert onto bone. So when you have bleeding in the scalp, it can come and accumulate around the subcutaneous tissue of the eyelid. The skin of the eyelid is the thinnest skin in the body, and it's very delicate and sensitive. Usually it has loose subcutaneous tissue. And when you have a slight injury or inflammation at the eyelid, fluid accumulates, leading to swelling. Now, when there's a blow to the eye, especially the periorbital region, there'll be soft tissue damage. So what happens? The tissue is actually crushed against the strong, sharp margin of the skull. And that's what gives you black eyes or raccoon eyes, which we call the periorbital ecchymosis. So what's the blood supply of the scalp? You have arteries. The scalp is a site for internal and external carotid artery anastomosis. What do I mean by this? The supratrochlear and supraorbital arteries, they come from ophthalmic artery, which is from internal carotid artery, while superficial temporal, posterior auricular, and occipital arteries are branches of external carotid artery. Therefore, the scalp becomes a site of external and internal carotid artery communication. Supratrochlear, supraorbital from ICA and the rest from ECA. The nerve supply, you have anteriorly from supratrochlear and supraorbital, which are from ophthalmic nerve, which is the first division of trigeminal. Then you have zygomaticotemporal from maxillary nerve, which is second division of trigeminal. You have auriculotemporal from mandibular nerve, which is third division of trigeminal. Then posteriorly, the scalp is supplied by lesser occipital nerve, greater occipital nerve, and the third occipital nerve. So those are the nerves that supply the scalp. Lymphatic drainage of the scalp. The anterior part of the scalp drains into parotid nodes, which we also call the preauricular. They are in front of the auricle. The posterior part of the scalp drain onto mastoid group of nodes and also the occipital lymph nodes. So in the next lecture series, we'll discuss the anatomy of the face. Thank you.